good morning. I'm Barbara Bodine, and I'm the director of the Institute for the Study of Diplomacy at Georgetown University, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to the first Diverse Diplomacy lecture of this academic year. The Diverse Diplomacy series was established almost 2 years ago in order to both celebrate the diversity of the Department of State and the Foreign Service, and also to explore with a great deal of candor the realities of serving in diplomacy, serving in the foreign affairs community, and serving in the Department of State. Both the obstacles and the opportunities, the limitations and the rewards. And as part of this, we invite a remarkable breadth of career officers who have served their country for many years to talk about their own personal experiences, their own insights, and to receive their own wisdom. We are honored that this year our first guest is Ambassador Dereck Hogan. Ambassador Hogan is a career member of the Senior Foreign Service and was sworn in as ambassador to the Embassy Moldova, and is the first Pickering Fellow to be appointed as ambassador. So congratulations, Ambassador Hogan, on first your ambassadorship, which is always a major milestone, and for representing the promise of the Pickering and Rangel Fellows when it was established. He's had a very distinguished career. He served as Deputy Executive Secretary of the Department of State. He was Deputy Chief of Mission in Chargé d'Affaires in Baku, Azerbaijan. And if this were a different sort of panel, we'd be asking him about that war. He was also the Director of Central European Affairs and Nordic Baltic Affairs, Senior Advisor to the President's Special Representative on Afghanistan and Pakistan following two tours with Provincial Reconstruction Teams. And he's also served in Russia, Belarus, Nicaragua, and the Dominican Republic. He was Special Assistant to Secretary of State Colin Powell and a watch officer, which for those inside will know what that means. It's a high pressure job, and only the best officers are selected for that. He received his bachelor's degree from the University of Pittsburgh and a master's degree in public affairs from Princeton School of Public and International Affairs. He speaks Russian, Spanish, and Romanian. So this is truly a distinguished officer, and we could not be more pleased. I'm going to take a privilege of the chair and ask the ambassador the first question, which is the foundation question. Why did you choose to go into foreign affairs? What drew you to the Department of State? What is your origin story, Ambassador?
Thank you, Ambassador Bodine, and thank you, Georgetown, for this opportunity to be part of this incredible series. I had the opportunity to look at some of the videos of others who participated in this diversity series. And, you know, these are my role models. These are people that I grew up, if you will, in the Foreign Service, you know, just wanting to be more alike. And so to be among that group is truly an honor and a privilege for me. The question that you asked is an important one that I often think about even now, 23 years later, what got me into this career. It goes back to when I was 16 years old. I was living in the state of Pennsylvania, and my parents thought I needed to find something interesting to do during the summer break between my junior and senior year in high school. And so there is this program called the Pennsylvania Governor School of Excellence for International Studies. So with a lot of help from them, you know, we submitted the application, and I was thankful to be selected for that group. It was about 60 of us from around the state. And during that summer, two Foreign Service officers came to speak to us. And this is the year 1990. So you can imagine lots of really interesting things were happening in that year. And they were describing a role in which they themselves, as well as their colleagues in the Foreign Service, helped to contribute to some really, really fascinating developments around the world. They spoke of public service. They spoke of learning about cultures, interacting with those cultures, promoting our values, but also understanding the values of others, and seeing what we can do to bridge the gap, bridge the people-to-people gap, bridge the policy-to-policy gap. And I was hooked from that very moment. And so I said, I want to do that. I want to live overseas. I want to, you know, help make the world a better place. And I want to do that on behalf of the U.S. government. And so from that moment on, I charted my course. I enrolled in a major at the University of Pittsburgh that will hopefully take me to the point of being prepared to take the Foreign Service exam. And was at the University of Pittsburgh in my second year. The dean of the Honors College mentioned to me that there's this new program called the Woodrow Wilson Foreign Affairs Program. And it's sort of like the ROTC, the Army ROTC, where, you know, you actually had the rest of your college years paid for. So my junior and senior year, then your graduate degree in international affairs. And then if you pass the Foreign Service exam, and they were going to work hard to make sure that we do pass all the preparation for that, we would have to serve a minimum of four years. I said, you know, you had me at hello when you said that this was a way to be able to join the Foreign Service and to be prepared to take the exam. And so I was really excited. You know, we worked really hard to, to put forward a compelling application. And I was obviously thankful to have won that. And from that moment on, 7 years later, from the moment I actually won the fellowship to joining the Foreign Service, that was 7 years later, 23 years old, I was in. So I was very, very excited. And the preparation that they gave us, during the summers, to be able to understand what the Foreign Service is all about, to be able to understand, even just the basis of how to pass the written exam, what are things we should be focusing on, the oral exam. That sort of behind the scenes look into the process was very helpful, so that when I joined, in 1997 in the A100 class, even though I was young, I was one of the youngest people in the class, my life had been the Foreign Service for 7 years prior. So mm-hmm. I felt very comfortable going into this incredible career.
Well, that's a wonderful story. As somebody who also got hooked at 15, I understand your story.
Okay, you know what I'm saying.
I know what you're saying. I know exactly what you're saying. But that's and to describe the Pickering Wrangell as kind of our ROTC is took us a while to get around to it. But thank you. I would love to stay and chat with you for the whole hour, but this is a program that was designed, devised, and launched by a former Dean of Virginia Rusk Fellow at ISD. And as part of the tradition, the Rusk Fellows are the ones who actually run this series. So my job is to know when to get out of the way. You know, ambassadors are always invited to parties, but our job is to leave early so everyone else can do it.
Exactly. So
that's what I'm about to do. And it is my absolute pleasure to introduce Hamid Hamid, who is one of our two Rusk Fellows, and these are FSOs, mid-career. Mm-hmm. And Hamid comes to us from being the Special Assistant to the Deputy Secretary of State, where he was responsible for Western Hemisphere Affairs, Foreign Assistance, mm-hmm. Human Rights, Migration, Counter-Narcotics, Mass Atrocities, the Prevention Thereof, obviously, and Other Conflict Prevention, religious freedom and trafficking in persons. So I'm not really quite sure what anyone else in the office was doing, but he had a very important portfolio. He had previously served in Mexico City and in the Libya external office in Tunisia. He's also served in Caracas and on the Kuwait desk in Washington. He was a Fulbright scholar, co-founded Inspired Dreams, an NGO that focuses on youth programs for refugees in the West Bank. He holds an MA from the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy and a BA from the Edmund Walsh School of Foreign Service at Georgetown. And so with great pleasure and a little regret, because I would actually like to do this, I turn the program over to Hamid. Thank you. Thank you both.
Thank you, Ambassador. Thank you very much for the introduction again.
It was my pleasure.
Thanks so much, Ambassador Bodine, and welcome again, Ambassador Hogan. Thanks so much for joining us today. I'll quickly turn to the next question, since I know we want to get to the audience questions as well, which is, how do you see yourself and how do you think others see you within this foreign affairs world? What ways do you identify, and how do you think that has shaped your approach to your work and others' approaches to you? Over to you, Ambassador.
Thank you. I see myself as someone who's extremely blessed to be doing what we are doing. I think, you know, we have the opportunity to shape, and not just the opportunity, the mandate, to shape our countries and our people's relations with the rest of the world, to promote a world in which our values, our interests are advanced. And so first and foremost, I think when people, particularly, you know, in the Foreign Service, in the interagency community, and quite frankly, outside, you know, here in Moldova or in other countries where I serve, what I hear from them is that they see someone who's passionate about what he does. They see someone who is almost smitten with what he does. That this is something where he has to pinch himself every once in a while and say, you know, is this really happening to me? So that's the first thing, is that I see myself as someone who loves what he does. And as a student of diplomacy and to the best of my ability, a practitioner of it. I mean, obviously, I see myself as and I know who I am in terms of being an African American. A person of faith, a person who, with my wife, my tour, my first tour was in the Dominican Republic, and I, like many. Many Foreign Service officers went to a country single, my first tour single, left married. And so that's myself that included in that. And so multicultural as well, because, you know, we've been married for 21 years now. And so her culture, her family, being Dominican, has also become part of my culture, part of my family. So in that way, I see myself as multicultural. And I would also say I see myself as someone who tries to be a catalyst for change, a catalyst for positive change. And what I mean by that is even in my first tour in Santo Domingo, that was my first tour working in the consular section, very large section. We were probably, I was one of 25, 27 first or second tour Foreign Service officers. And I remember thinking, even at that time, there are a whole bunch of us doing this job that seems, if we want to reduce it, it can seem mundane, it can seem rote. But the challenge I put on myself is, yeah, but what difference can I make here? What is the small difference that I can make? Even though, yes, all of us are lined up in a row, 15 of us, you know, at one time. At that time, we were literally stamping visas. But what we are doing, I can fall into the trap of this is just, you know, the routine for the next 2 years, or I can look at what we're doing as a mission and see what can I do differently, or what can I do to contribute to that mission. So in that particular case, it was working with our leadership, our consular leadership, to improve our customer service, you know, to provide a better face to the consular section. And so there's a lot of activities in that we launched. But my point is, ever since that first tour, I've always tried to figure out what I can do to make it just a little bit better. And then fast forwarding it all the way to where I am right now, where I have the opportunity to shape a mission and the organizational culture within that mission, I put the organizational environment on par with the policy promotion. Meaning, if I am making sure that everyone understands what our values are, and diversity and inclusion are part and parcel of that ideal working environment that we've established here, then I know that my team is going to be producing at even a higher octane. They're going to be doing it with passion, with gusto, because they feel respected, they feel recognized, they feel valued. And so to me, I see that as concomitant with actually just the day-to-day policy promotion, pushing the policy, because we're gonna do it in a more effective way. We're gonna be much more entrepreneurial about it, for example. So that catalyst for change is something that hopefully, when people look at me, they see that that is what I'm trying to do.
Ambassador, how do I sign up to join that team? Thank you for that.
Big Keisha now.
Thank you for that, Ambassador. Looking more at the big picture, kind of in broader perspective of the State Department, how do you think throughout your career the State Department's approach to a diverse and inclusive workforce has changed? And what policies or programs or initiatives have you seen that actively support and encourage that change?
So 23 years now for me, it has been, I see a much more systematic approach, a much more open and candid approach to putting at the level it should be a diversity and inclusion. It's not to say that in earlier stages of my career, there weren't people who were actively pushing for this, and I can tell you, and this is something I wanted to to stress in this conversation, I really believe in the power of one. I really believe in what one person can do to shape his or her sphere of influence, right? Whether you're an entry-level officer and you're on the visa mill, like I described earlier, or you're heading up a unit or a section or an office in Washington, if we think about what really is in our responsibility, we can make change for the better. And I'll never forget, I was in a mid-level, senior to mid-senior. So I was a baby two. I was a baby FSO two. And I was looking at it was a stretch position in a big embassy. And I'll never forget the DCM with whom I was interviewing. This was Embassy Moscow. The DCM, he got it. He believed in the power of one. He said, Dereck, I've known you for a few years now since our days working together in Washington, and you can do the job. There's a whole bunch of other bidders on this job. I think you would be able to go up against any of them. But we have a real challenge here in Embassy Moscow. And again, this is, 15 years ago. He said, we have a mission that doesn't look like America. And this was during a time in Russia where neo-Nazism was on the rise, was resurgent again. And he said, both our embassy community as well as the Russian people needed to see that we are putting, and we do value people from all walks of life, including from all colors. That's who we are as a nation. So he was very intentional about putting, he actually gave the job to me, this senior leadership position in the embassy, based on merit. I mean, because he said, you know, if I hadn't qualified, we wouldn't have even had a conversation. But he was intentional about changing the dynamics there. And you know, that was one DCM who made a difference, because then, you know, I took that philosophy into my head. I'm like, wait a minute, if he can do that, why can't I do that? Right. And so, for example, with the Pickering fellows, when I was at Pickering, as well as Rango fellows, when I was at DCM in Azerbaijan, I reached out to the Pickering and Rango fellows and you know, the organizations, and said, listen, I want to have a stable stream of summer interns from the Pickering and Rango fellows. They said, well, that's very good, but we're going to need housing. That's no worry about housing. I'll find housing for you. You know, we're going to need, you know, all the accommodations. I said, not a problem. We'll take care of it. But I want these people here because I want them, you know, to work in a place where at least I can be assured that, you know, that the whole team is going to be investing in them. And so I had conversations with all the leadership team at the embassy. I obviously talked to my ambassador and said, this is what I think we should do. These are the future. These are, you know, incoming leaders. You know, let's invest in them now. That's what people did with me. And so, again, I give these examples because while we are doing what we should be doing right now, taking a very systematic approach, I love what the DG is doing. I participated a few weeks ago in the kickoff of WHA and MED's 21-day racial equity challenge, a very, very good idea. More than 300 people participating in. Those are those big macro level things that are so important to turn this 73,000 person, you know, ship, you know, sort of more in the right direction. But I think we should also realize that we have authority, we have responsibility, we have opportunities, each one of us. And so the power of one should never be discarded, even as we look to these systematic changes that are happening.
Thank you, Ambassador. As we talk about the power of one, can you tell us about one of your champions or mentors and how that influence your career? You touched on this a little bit, but kind of, is there another example you can use and how that's informed how you inspire the next generation of diplomats?
Yeah, I will speak about it. I'll give one example of a person who helped me in terms of, you know, how to orient my career. But being an African American himself, it was obviously that went into the picture as well. And it's a person that probably many people on the call know, and he's a mentor to a whole bunch of us, is Ambassador Harry Thomas. He retired, I think now a couple of years ago. But I remember calling him when I was, mid-level officer. But I was looking to figure out what do I do after one particular tour, and I remember him, and there was a job where I would have gone to become a head of a section, a combined section, in a very big section. I was a head of a section, but it was a smaller section. This job would have been a bigger section, or go to a bigger embassy, but be in a smaller, you know, because it's a bigger section, just be sort of a unit chief type of a position. And he said, Dereck, you're going to make it to one. Don't worry about that. Cause I was like, well, you know, if I take this job, am I going to, you know, one, is that a real thing for me? And again, I mean, anxieties, whatever you want to call it, but I wasn't sure, right? You know, what move was gonna, you know, take me off course, if you will. And I remember him just telling me, slow your roll, calm down. You're gonna make it to one. You need to be focused on the skills that will help you excel at the one level and beyond. So don't just look for the job that you think will check the box, that you know, that you think will get you to one faster. Take the jobs that will round out your skills so that you can excel in the higher level positions. And that was so enlightening for me, And so I did that. I followed his advice, and I don't regret that. In every stage, you know, from one to OC, I had another conversation with them. From OC to MC, you know, I had another conversation with them. I mean, these are the sorts of people who are always there for you. When I was, you know, thinking about putting my name in for an ambassadorship, he sort of gave me the inside scoop because, you know, he was an exec sec and DG, so knows how the D committee works well. These are the sorts of people that that have profoundly shaped my life. One, in terms of my career, but two, as being a person of color, he shared with me his perspective in terms of how to deal with the range of issues, both, you know, in the office as well as outside the office. And so obviously that has prompted me to do as much as I can to help those who were earlier in their career. So yeah, those people are golden, and we got to find them and hold on to them.
Thank you, Ambassador. And on the flip side, I guess we've all had situations in our careers where because of how people perceived who we are or our abilities, they've kind of taken or felt that our perspectives in a professional or policy discussions were not valued. Was there ever a situation in your career where you were perceived differently because of who someone perceived you to be rather than the proposals themselves? And if so, what tools and resources did you draw on to deal with that situation?
I'm gonna try to nuance that question a little bit. I think that when it comes to being, you know, being a person of color or someone perceiving me or perceiving my ideas through a different way because of my color, I really can't think of many, I can't think actually honestly of any example of that. I will give you some examples where I think because of the other characteristics I have, you know, that was a factor. But just to dwell on that for a moment. For me, you know, presenting an idea, presenting a proposal should be done with a lot of consideration. There should be a lot of anticipation of what the counter arguments are. I rarely just raise my hand and just say, hey, boss, I got something for you, blah, blah, blah. Most of the times, if I have the opportunity to, I will actually write it out. I'll write out my idea because when I write it, the idea is more crystallized. And when I write it, I see, I'm not sure that's as great as idea you thought it was. It sounded good in your head, but you know, when you actually put it out there, you know, on paper, is this really gonna fly? And so that's a really good filter for me. So by the time I go in and present my idea, I find that people either like the idea because of the merit of the idea, or they don't like the idea because of, you know, the lack of merit. But I haven't sensed, I haven't even sensed that they didn't like the idea because they looked at me and said, ugh, we don't like it. Where I can tell you, other characteristics about me have played a role, I think, is in the age factor. Where when, you know, because of, the leadership position that I had relatively earlier in my career, I was supervising people who were more advanced in years as well as more advanced in tours, actually. So there were a couple of occasions where I felt that just because I presented it, it wasn't a good idea. And I had a little back and forth with them, with it on this, and you know, one case in particular, the person told me, I have to be honest, I look at you and I say, why are you in that position and why am not? And why am I not in that position? You know, I've got more years than you in the service, you know, I'm older than you, and I've been around the block, and I just can't understand why the leadership chose to put you in that position and not me. And so, that particular case, you know, when I deal with something like that, first of all, going to the tools that you described or the ways I've sort of navigated those stormy waters, I would say, first of all, is take the person aside. I took this person aside, invited this person to coffee, and didn't go right into the issue and say, this is my problem. I asked, how are things going? How do you see things going? How do you see the relationship? What can I do to advance this relationship? You know, where am I? How can I, improve my leadership skills or my relationship with you? Because I want to make sure this relationship works. On the three occasions that, you know, I've been in that situation, that quickly lowered the tensions, that lowered the temperature, and the person began to open up and say to me what I just told you a few minutes ago. I don't like the fact that, you know, you're older than me. I'm sorry that I'm older than you. I don't like the fact that I've got more years in the service than you. So first step is try to get out, try to suss out, try to elicit from the person in as disarming a way as possible what the issues are. Yes, it's going to be difficult for someone to say, I don't like you because, you know, whatever, you're Mexican American, or I don't like you because you're African American, or I don't like you because you're a woman, or I don't like you because you're a man. I mean, those are some, in an EEO sensitive world as we are right now, people saying that are likely to, to find themselves in a world of a trouble. But the more you try to elicit in as disarming a way as possible what the issues are, and making sure that person knows that you are all about trying to make it work, number one, and number two, you are not making any assumptions. You know, you're not going in there thinking, you know, you don't like me because of X. No, you're going to give that person the benefit of the doubt and ask and try to figure out what's really happening. Second of all, in my particular case, I said, I know how difficult that can be for you. If I were in your shoes, that would be very challenging for me too. So it's the relatability factor. Try to relate to the person to the extent where you can. There may be some issues where there's no relationship whatsoever. You can't even, you know, go that step. But in this particular case, I was able to do that. And then the third step for me in the three cases that I'm thinking of involved saying, okay, so I know where you're coming from, and I'm gonna do my best to understand and to make sure you know that I am counting on your expertise, that I am counting on your wisdom, that I am counting on your years of experience here. And at the same time, I'm counting on you, person X, to support me as I try to lead this team, because I can't abdicate my responsibility. You wouldn't want me to abdicate my responsibility. You wouldn't abdicate your responsibility if you were in this position. So we're gonna figure out how we can make this work. So it was a polite way of saying, I understand what you're saying, but we have got to move forward, because I'm not going to change. I'm not going to move away and step away from my responsibility. I'm grateful for this opportunity. And if I mess up, it's on me, but I'm counting on you to help us as a team, because if I mess up, that's a reflection on you as well. So we were able to take the relationship from probably like a C minus to maybe a B plus. I never got it to the A plus level, but that's okay. We found a modus operandi, right? And so if it's not able to be worked out this way, then I do think a person needs to bring in others, but you do it judiciously. You pull in your boss. If that doesn't work, you know, you pull in your, you know, the EEO counselor. If that doesn't work, then you go to EEO Washington, OCR. If one of the issues is one of those fundamentals those fundamental rights that are protected under the EEO laws. So I think we try to deal with it in a one-on-one way. And then over time, as you're getting the reactions from this person, then you expand that circle so that you're bringing in the right people. What I would always say is that you don't live with it. You don't stay in that situation. If I hadn't worked it out with these people, particularly, you know, in my situation in terms of age gap and experience gap, then I certainly would have kicked it up. I totally would have kicked it up. But but we don't need to live with it is another sort of countervailing factor.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Ambassador. And I think Ambassador Bodine wanted to say a closing word as well. Ambassador Bodine?
I'm not sure I'm on.
Yeah.
But you're on.
Okay, I'm on? Okay. This wonderful world of Zoom is something I'm still coming to terms with.
I know.
Yeah. I just wanted to thank you. That was, if you know, I almost want to go back and take the test again and start the career again. You were candid. You were honest. You were certainly inspiring. Your practical advice was spot on. Particularly, you've got to know how to write. I just want to thank you for representing our country, for choosing to serve. And my best wishes to your family. I know that getting dragged around the world is, I always thought was fabulous, but it still is. And you're very, I think the one thing I'm gonna take away of the many things you said was to always remember the power of one.